a rematch of last split's quarterfinal that Liquid had 3-0'd convincingly and sent energy packing early on. There's Quasis, Lowy getting banned, prompting smiles from the whole energy lineup.
Yeah, went back and rewatched that game. Death's Dance first on a Lowy from Quas.
Mm-hmm.
They had the Lowy Ziggs poke comp,
right,
essentially. So really, Team Liquid's like, that is just ridiculous. Let's make sure they can't do that again. Just too weird. It's not even like, you don't even know if it's going to be good. It's just weird.
It is. I remember before the game started that week, Zaurine and I went over and like looked at pro builds for all these players. Like, what's everyone else doing? Centaurin's like, or Quas is the one guy doing Death Dance first. But everyone has their own ideas of what's good on Alawi.
Yeah, everyone builds something else. Is it a Trinity Force? Is it Black Cleaver?
Right.
Is it just pure tank?
Mm-hmm.
So many different options. But we don't get to talk about this game, Freak, because Team Liquid banned it.
Yeah.
So
we'll stop with the Alawi talk for now.
No, it's fine.
Yeah, they just remove all the fun. Thanks, Liquid.
Yeah.
You're the worst. Trundle off the board, though, and I want to see actually what sort of style Liquid chooses to adopt here. Now that they're up against, I would say, tougher competition, I think Liquid really has to put their best foot forward here, and we've seen Lorlu do quite well on fighters like Irelia, like Trundle, and do much worse on tanks like Maokai. I actually do think Liquid should play a more top-focused, top-carry-focused style.
Especially when they still have Fab and getting used to the LCS split. But the question here is, do they pick Vladimir right off the bat? Because there's been a lot that hasn't been banned through. Irelia could be a priority in the top lane, Vladimir could be a priority in the mid lane, and that's not even talking about the Rek'Sai when there's two jungle bans. So there is a lot they're going to have to decide on, and they do end up going with Vladimir.
Okay, yeah, if I'm just playing tier list picks right now, I would say it probably is Rek'Sai plus Irelia, but there's a lot more to consider. You saw CLG seemed happy to play Jax in the matchup both times, even though we had seen their opponents basically first round Irelia both games. Darshan seemed to be okay on the Jax, but that's one player in one matchup.
Part of what I like about this patch is the top lane doesn't feel like it's figured out yet.
No.
So we definitely get to see different teams having different ideas on what is best. I agree with you on the Rek'Sai being what would be an obvious pick here.
Yeah, it's perceived powerful.
Yeah, and then the Irelia would be if Quas had played it at all this split, but he's pretty much just played Maokai, Vladimir, Ekko, and Alawi as his only unique champion.
And the things that aren't Maokai are 1x each, and then it's just more Maokai games. But Kiwi Kid gets his Zyra. That's another one who's really up there. And yeah, Rek'Sai as we do come through. But yeah, Zyra definitely a really huge champion. I think she's absolutely one of the very best supports, and Kiwi Kid believes so.
Yeah, and Kiwi Kid has practiced on it as well. So if you're talking about individual team tier lists, this makes more sense for them to pick over the Irelia, mainly because it's been banned against them 4 times so far, as well as given them the victory against Envy in week one, and even a win against Immortals when they had support Zyra. So like, they've beaten some really good teams with support Zyra. The question will be though, can they deal with Lorlu's Irelia, which would be likely for Team Liquid to pick in this next set of picks?
Yeah, honestly, that's what I would do if I were Lokodoka, but of course he knows his team better than I know Liquid, so we'll see what their choices actually end up being here. Shout out to the super hype pregame music, by the way. I don't remember hearing this track before, but I am so pumped for the battle to come.
Yeah. A lot of the music is custom. A lot of the music is just hand-selected by our very talented producers here.
Yes.
Yeah, it's the Irelia and the Ashe for some more initiation. I like that pick of the Ashe, actually. Also, I like it early because Ashe-Zyra can be a devastating combo, but it also fits very well with the Vladimir and the Irelia because those are already your two solo lane picks, and the amount of team fight initiation is extremely low, so you then bring more initiation from the marksman role.
Right,
and it works out very well.
You don't want to get taken away. So here comes the insta-lock on Anivia, basically. So we will see Anivia into Vladimir. Many different mid laners have different opinions on this. The general trend was that Anivia is supposed to win the matchup, and then we heard Pobelter say, actually, it just turns out the Vladimirs are bad, and it should be fine for him. So, you know, just one more data point here, but GVM seems to like the matchup.
Yeah, I think it's a good matchup. Not like it's, oh my goodness, we should just let them have Vladimir and we'll play Anivia, but it's a good champion to control the mid lane and make it so Vladimir doesn't get freedom on the map. Not to mention Anivia scales really aggressively as well. So I think it's a totally fine thing to take in this matchup.
And the Jax does come through. So once again, we're seeing teams happy to pick that. And it's also Quas playing a much more sort of carry-focused role. Yes, he played a Vladimir game before, but, well, he was 0-6-2 on that champion. But they're putting him on a look, do well or be useless champion. And look, Quas has to.
Yeah, and a lot of it will be on Santorin being able to get him priority against Lorlo and Dardoch. So that's going to be a really interesting 2v2 is You know, the Olaf Aurelia versus the Jax Rek'Sai, those are guys that can fight a lot in the top lane. So I'm expecting a lot of skirmishing based on these picks.
And the entire bot lane of Liquid right now have just plenty of engage. Probably the two best overall, Ashe and Bard. Long range, lock you down, make sure the team gets in range here and let Olaf and Aurelia go to town on you. So big damage threats kind of across the board, plenty of CC, just not a ton of mobility is what the Liquid lineup looks like here. Except for maybe Magical Journey and Energy to lock in their last pick. So far seem pretty consistent team fighters, a lot of sort of area control.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's a good chance we could see some pretty explosive team fights. I also like the fact that Matt has gone back towards Bard. Yeah. It used to be like by far his best champion. It's what he was known for. And he's only played it once this split in over 10 games. And previously, Team Liquid had said they kind of keep Matt off Bard sometimes because he gets so in the zone with this really difficult champion to play that his shot calling can suffer as a result. Mm. But I feel like now, with Dardoch having more confidence after being reinstated into the team, like maybe he can take more of that role on and Matt can just kind of focus, or Matt has just gotten more comfortable on it and can do both. Either way, it's always good to have some of your best players on their best champions.
Absolutely agree. And speaking of that, OQ on his basically trademark Ezreal, he picks that, I would say, more than half the time when it's available, no matter what the meta is like, no matter what the champions are. He wants to play the Ezreal, so OQ definitely on some comfort. And Kwas back on a carry, used to be so well known for that style. Hasn't quite had the same split that he's had historically, but maybe this will be his return to form. His energy have consistently gotten better over time. And now we'll see if they can get themselves out of that 1-3 standings. Liquid go back to a 500 here if they could win and be 3-3 at the end of the week.
Yeah, and Energy will be able to basically tie Liquid in the standings with the win and have a head-to-head tiebreaker. So still a lot on the line for these guys. Is even though we don't want to look too far ahead, like they're going to be jockeying for playoffs. Probably competing against each other unless Liquid really turns around at some point in the season. And these team compositions will create a really interesting game.
It definitely will. The top lane matchup going to be interesting. The junglers also excellent players themselves. The coaches shake hands. They've met before. They coached last split as well. We are here to get ourselves into game one of the best of three. You guys at home, don't forget to vote for the team you want to see come out on top here in game one. Get online and tweet the hashtag TLWinner, hashtag NRGWin for which squad it's going to be. But we are here to go with Kwas against his old team. He said LCS just doesn't quite feel the same when you're not on Liquid. But he's got to do it here with the energy squad. OQ on his Ezreal and Fabi with his second LCS match here for Liquid, hoping to take it home and bring them up to 3-3. Here we go into game one.
Yeah, Fabi got to play Ashe yesterday as well. Had some decent arrows, but really those games were carried by Phoenix. He had back-to-back Azir player of the games. Unfortunately, we do have a quick pause at the start of the match.
It's okay.
Yeah, this does give me some time to talk about the team compositions, though, because I mentioned how it looks like KiwiKid is having some audio issues. I mentioned how I feel like these team compositions will create a lot of conflict. So a couple things that I really like about this.
Okay.
The top lane matchup for Team Liquid, they have Aurelia top lane, Olaf jungle, versus the Jax top lane and Rek'Sai jungle. The early pathing from both the Olaf and the Rek'Sai is so important because whoever gets an early advantage in the Jax versus Aurelia matchup can kind of take over the game, especially when they go to start trying to assassinate the AD carries. The other thing that's really interesting to me is the two very powerful laning supports, right?
Right.
A lot of people don't even consider laning against the Zyra because it can be so dominating and just force you into a lane swap. But Bard is potentially the strongest support at level one. So if you get ahead of Zyra, then you might not have to lane swap on that. So I think there's a lot of very early decisions that could have a very large impact on this game.
I absolutely agree. So we'll have to see how those things all play out. Also keep in mind that as time goes on, you talk about the supports being lane dominant. Just imagine when Fabi hits level six, like what's Zyra going to do to an Ashe arrow except flash it and then die? So there's certainly some threats there. And like after you flash one, then Matt ults you. Like just imagine if Liquid gets to level six without too many difficulties, they can kill almost anyone they want at any given time. And most of energy can't run away from it. So certainly a lot to be considered on all these sides. I definitely agree. Zyra is really scary. She has a license to print money as well. Her plants apply spell thieves. So you are always the richest player in the bot lane.
And she can kind of deny the other person's spell thieves, right? If they last hit a plant, it makes them go on cooldown for being able to get spell thieves.
Until 6:13, when it's changing, thankfully.
Yeah. Future patch noting. You can read the PB updates if you're Googling good enough.
Yeah, thankfully, Toshi, we also posted it on the forums. Zephyrus posted a bunch of stuff about what's going on in 613, all the support help. Thankfully, I'm a scumbag Zyra player, so I don't have to, you know, feel the short end of the stick. I just get the free gold and feel good about myself, build all the Andries. And KiwiKid likely as well. I'm going to check something real quick. KiwiKid, I want to see what his rune page is. And sadly, the pause timer blocked his list of armor pen.
Well, what's interesting is KiwiKid doesn't go very defensive on the Zyra. You can tell that he has 30 magic resist right now. So
yeah.
Any type of magic damage that Matt will be throwing at him in lane is going to be kind of full harass.
Right. KiwiKid has 23 magic pen at level 1 right now, which is probably like a full rune page and maybe hybrid pen marks. But it's going to be something very, very offensive. I actually went and did the math on proper Zyra rune pages a couple nights ago because I was curious.
Yeah.
And it was actually, I think AP Quints are slightly better than Pen Quints, but it's a really minor point.
Interesting.
Yeah. Either way, though, I've been informed that since this will be a bit of a longer pause, we're trying to fix a headset issue on KiwiKid because we're going to toss you over to what's going on in one of the other games, I believe.
Yeah, Phoenix correct. One's game over in the other studio.
Yeah.
Which we'll be going to right now.
So we'll see you soon.
Only has a few seconds left on it, and there it goes, it ticked off right now. But still, they have so much damage to get through these turrets. Yeah, Apex dropped the turrets. They're gonna drop the Nexus, and that's gonna be Apex taking game number one.
No.
Oh, no, wait.
There we go.
There it is. Apex taking game one.
Yeah, that's...
See you soon.
That's the game. We're done with the game now.
You see,
so we can come back.
In 2016, when a Riot employee says soon, it actually means soon, guys.
Come back right away. Man, what a game. We're going to have to watch that one later. So looks like Apex won.
Yes, they did.
That's great.
Pretty sure.
Congratulations to them.
Apex 1 and 0. Sadly, Phoenix 1's having a very hard time making everything work, but
yeah,
another loss, at least in a game. The series is still
alive. It'll obviously be best of three, so Apex looking like very aggressive. By the way, the reason that it is more delayed is they're actually replacing the headset on stage for good old KiwiKid right there. What's up, dude? There we go.
Hi, KiwiKid.
Thanks for the delay, Kiwi.
Cheers for him.
He can't hear us anymore. He put his headset back on.
That's true.
Gives him the thumbs up. So I haven't even received word that it's fixed, but it's looking like it's probably trending towards a resolution here.
Yeah. Well, I've just been told we're going to do the ready check with him. Be like, can you talk? Do they hear you? Okay, now have your teammates talk. Can you hear them? Good. Wonderful. How's game sounds? All right, we're good.
Yeah, they're all typing ready in game. I see a couple people pressing R.
They're typing R.
Yeah, well, it's an abbreviation.
I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm being pedantic, and that's never fun.
It's interesting, right? Because, like, OQ, is that an abbreviation, or is it
almost
an acronym for something?
Or is he trying to cast his ultimate at 20 seconds in?
Oh, Q, press that.
Yeah.
That's why he likes Ezreal.
Actually, it's because his name is Ogumin, so it's actually his name, basically. It's the same reason that Ezihun's name is what it is, because his name is Ezihun.
Thank you for the actual answer.
That
is much better than me guessing. All right, I'm happy we're into the game now. We've already talked about the jungle priority early on, Darduk versus Santorin. It is our featured matchup for a reason. Both these guys have been performing at very high level, but also in how that will enable Lorlo and Kwass, two guys who have been struggling, but have also been able to carry a few games when the jungler has given them priority. So you look at that with two kind of utility or later game AD carries, and we're expecting a lot of focus to really just be on those 2v2s on whichever side of the map the top laners decide to go.
GBM gets axed. First bit of damage comes through, and that's Darduk getting first blood, depending on how you define it. Not in the official terms, obviously, but, you know, there was damage done. Ice was chopped off. Actually, isn't Olaf by tradition like an ice... like, you know the movie Frozen? Wait, no, Olaf was a
like the
snowman.
Disney movie?
Darn.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they're... yeah. Okay, we're going to move on because I screwed this one up really horribly.
Right,
Liquid, Matt, and Fabi, though, running to the top side of the jungle, looking to do a bit of an invade, but Energy actually outnumber them over here.
Yeah, this is a real interesting call for the lane swap. They actually have four people in the jungle, so if they wanted to collapse, they could kill him. Great stun by Matt, though.
Double stun lands, but there's the flash away because KiwiKid says, hi, if he learns root, Matt's like actually just dead.
Yeah, he flashed the root, I believe. KiwiKid had already missed it, so he'd have to get
KiwiKid
the next...
KiwiKid has Q anyway.
Oh, yeah, never mind.
If he had actually learned root, Matt would actually be dead right now with the team following, but instead, Fabi taking a bit of damage. A quick stun comes out from Matt. And it still is summoner lost for Liquid, and it's not like Rek'Sai and Jax really lost any time. Kwass teleported down to the bot lane to match with Lorlo's Aurelia, and we're good to go.
Oh, another
stun on an OQ. Exhaust on already. They want him right away. Summoner heal burn, but two attacks will kill him. He's trying one more, and Fabi does not want to dive the turret. His flash was up. He could have gone for the trade kill.
He could have flashed for a guaranteed first blood, but also a guaranteed death of his own. So Decides to play it safe, just take the lane advantage. He doesn't want the minions to crash and give a bunch of experience to Kiwi Kid. There's also a chance Kiwi Kid could have turned it around for double kill since he still had flashing ignited and Matt was very low, but we talked about Bard's level one strength in lane, and
there you go.
We just got to see it. Matt lands a nice stun, and they go in.
Jett's crystal ball, not rusty after all these years. Looks still plenty clear. Yeah, also OQ is running, oh geez, Santorin's already here.
They had burned exhaust and flash, so we're thinking top lane. Santorin decides to go bot side. He's level three.
Matt has no sums. There's the knockup into the root, lands.
Beautiful.
That's gonna be all the damage. Perfectly played. First blood comes through, and now Fabi is gonna have to flash away and stay alive. But here comes the teleport in for Lorlo. Cannot be matched by Quas. Lorlo level two, has no one to stun, slows down OQ, but look at the damage output. Teleports in to die.
Oh, no.
And now a red buff to chase Fabi. This is catastrophic. This should be the kill. A double picked up, and now Dardock wants one, but can he get enough? He really wants Kiwi Kid. I don't know if he can quite do it, though. Gets rooted up. He gets getting one more axe, one more attack,
Kiwi!
And now a triple kill for Kiwi Kid. 4-1 for energy.
Kiwi Kid Zyra with the triple kill early on in the game. And Phoenix, it's not done yet. There are no summoners left.
There are more kills than minutes already, and Phoenix really wants to kill OQ. Lands the slow from the E, lands the Q. Auto attack, Q's back up, and down
Kiwi,
he goes.
Kiwi, look out, Phoenix has flash.
Uh-oh, pool, charge the E, flash, land it,
oh,
and
no.
There's one more picked up. A shutdown and double buffs on Phoenix. Woo! What a game!
Yeah, that's one way to start it. Double buffs on a Phoenix huge. Let's get into how this actually happened. So I love the gank pathing by Santorin to come up there and essentially beat Olaf to the spot because Santorin didn't bother doing blue buff. He had red side of the jungle, then came up for the gank. But then Lorlo and Fabi, they're both level two against a level three and two level two. So really poor choice by Lorlo to actually decide to go in on that. Therefore, they're able to get a few kills, but Dardock starts ghosting in, can secure a kill onto Santorin. And this is where it gets really crazy, because he's in a bunch of minions, and OQ and Kiwi Kid just have to kite him out. Kiwi Kid keeps landing the roots, and then places yet another spell right in front of him to pick up a triple kill. But they are not respecting the teleport from the Anivia and the number of wards that are in lane at the beginning of this fight. So they burned all their summoners. It's just a Vladimir who comes in here. And Kiwi Kid could have been completely free. I don't know why he came back into this fight.
He tried to peel Phoenix with a root.
Yeah, Phoenix is killing OQ, and he's like, maybe I could stop him, but he misses the root, and then when that happens, you know he's dead. Phoenix, with knowledge of Vladimir, understands you can cast E during Pool of Blood, so he makes it so he can't be counterattacked there at the very end of the fight, and just, that is a whole bunch of stuff happening 4.5 minutes in.
Yeah, it is, and Pool of Blood, of course, does give you both movement speed and a slow for people that you are underneath, I think. So, just even pressing W from outside of melee range allowed him to catch up and land everything. So yeah, beautiful play by Phoenix. He's gonna feel good about this one. GBM, I guess, did get a blue buff thanks Santorin, but not exactly a great start to this lane when Phoenix has a whole ton of gold, walks into the lane of the Spectre's Cowl, and can basically ignore anything else that GBM could do to him.
Yeah, the only thing that GBM can be happy about is the fact that he's level six with a blue buff, so he should be able to clear the wave for at least a little while. Hasn't gone back for a tier or a catalyst yet, so he has a very small mana pool. As soon as his blue buff is out, he's basically going to have to base and then run back without a teleport since he's decided to go ignite. And that is very unfortunate because he's gone ignite and has very little kill pressure since the Spectre's Cowl was able to be obtained so quickly by
right.
Phoenix.
Yeah, the ignite, you're right. Instead of running the teleport to help match teleports and whatnot, he's trying to knock down the healing output. Both the Zyra and the Anivia has that ignite. So like, it's for the champ select purposes of, hey, there's some self-healers. The Olaf, Aurelia, and Vlad all have really good self-healing.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of Anivias just take ignite because it's a surprising amount of kill pressure in lane once you're six. Just like pressing R and E on a dude a few times and then having the ignite for the surprise kill. I like the choice, but when you go a Spectre's Cowl early against Vladimir, it becomes less optimal.
All right, well, sadly, another quick pause here. This time it was Quas pausing the game. We'll see what the actual issue ended up being, but I didn't see anything in chat just yet. But we'll hear about that before too long. Okay, looks like it's the same issue, and it's actually for the same player as well. So Kiwi Kid having headset trouble once again, sadly. And this time, Phoenix One and Apex aren't in a game right now to toss to, so
you just
get us.
Yeah, well, apparently he is hearing a growling noise in his headset. One of the funniest sound-related pauses I've ever heard was from the European LCS.
That's right.
Where, do you remember the exact story?
I don't remember the exact story, but you can go for it.
Oh, no.
I'll fill in what details I can.
TLDR, he thought something was wrong with the headset, but it was actually one of his teammates just going like...
Yep.
And they couldn't figure it out. And then they And then in the notes, like, we send out notes at the end of the day for, like, what tech issues happen, and just, like, we asked the player to stop, and the issue was resolved. It was so funny.
There's usually, like, a column for, like, notes for next time, too, like, how to further resolve anytime this issue happens again, and it's like, tell players shut up. Like, there you go.
Either way, apparently 2 minutes towards a resolution of this one. Hopefully we're able to get it quick this time. I don't think it's TBM growling at KiwiKid. I think it's an actual audio issue.
Yeah, from what I heard, it was an in-game audio. So I don't know if his settings are off, if he has ambient noise on and didn't mean to, or I don't know. But it will be hopefully resolved reasonably quickly, and we'll be back to good to go in this game. So talk about the license to print money as a Zyra. Well, when you walk in a lane at 6 minutes with a Frostfang and a Sightstone, you're going to get 45 gold every, like, 30-ish seconds by hitting plants on people, and you can ward your lane forever, so even though KiwiKid's missing his flash, it's Darduk can't get over walls, so, like, he has to walk through wards to make anything really happen, unless Matt comes down and gives a magical journey, so Kiwi should be pretty safe to, like, constantly push and be the most annoying bot lane in the history of League of Legends, being Ezreal, Zyra with the gold lead.
I agree with that. I do think that when Darduk is level 6, which is now, like, it is still going to be a little scary. When I see the Olaf jungle get ahead against his Zyra support, like, that's the guy that Olaf just kills for the entirety of the mid game.
Yeah.
But if we speak about the gold generation, the difference between KiwiKid's Frostfang and Matt's Spell Thief's Edge, which is still sitting there unupgraded, it's already generated an extra 100 gold for KiwiKid just based off the early game, and that lead is only going to get larger based off of Zyra's ability to proc the spell, and also the fact that Frostfang will give just generally better gold generation as the game progresses.
Absolutely the case. So KiwiKid certainly in actually a pretty good position to, I would say, carry in a way. This whole team's going to kind of scale up, though. They've got two Tier of the Goddess picked up already. GBM has one. OQ has one. Quas is playing Jax. And by the way, because Quas never teleported to the top lane, Lorlo TP'd, then died, then walked back down, Quas is up 55 to 22 minions. Quas is actually level 6 to 5 right now. It's actually not even close. Quas is actually closer to level 7 than Lorlo is to level 6. In a lot of ways, Quas is actually smashing this lane because of Lorlo TPing and failing. Just going 0-1-0, getting nothing done there.
Yeah, collateral damage. Collateral damage from what happened very early on in the lane. Everyone wanting to become involved for Team Liquid, but Quas staying down a little bit. The issue is resolved, by the way. We've unpaused the game. And I think one of the biggest things to pay attention to when we get back in the game here is whether or not Quas can take that lead to the next level. It's going to be a little bit tricky going on in the game against an Ashe and a Bard and those things, and even an Aurelia that can stun him. Wouldn't be too surprised if we saw very early Mercury treads, but I can't wait to see it unfold.
Yeah, so in real time, the players are back in the game. We'll get the feed switch for you very shortly. Checking behind myself to make sure it wasn't just our issue, but we are into the game right now, and I'm just going to kind of look down and see what's going on so you guys don't miss the action here. As really just leaning back and forth right now, so nothing too special.
Yeah.
Quas is going to take.
Apologies for the tech issues, but we have a switcher problem. So the game is happening right now. You can see the players right in there, and they've actually, I believe, they paused it because
administrative pause.
It's an administrative pause because we'd love to be able to have people see the game.
Yeah, part of the point of esports is for you guys to watch it. So, all respect to the players, I'm sorry we paused your game for you, but you know, KiwiKid, if your sound doesn't work, sometimes we have to do it too. There we go. We have the feed on there. There we go, the beautiful gray screen. Not because we're all dead, but because the game is paused. And we will be getting ourselves back in. Just kidding, it's me once again, hello. It sucks, I'm always looking down, and then I look up, and like, oh, look, it's my bald spot. Oh, look, hey, I'm missing a lot of hair. Hi, how's it going? So every time, they just surprise me with the pause, and I'm just like...
I don't know how to respond to that.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
That why you decided to grow the beard?
No, it wasn't like as compensation. I mean, I know the Twitch emote Fungineer is great for everybody, but the story is actually, there's actually stuff going on. There's actually kills. Hopefully we get
those
back.
We're
back in a game and KiwiKid is dead.
That's exactly what we just talked about. Darduk hitting level 6, running directly at KiwiKid and killing him because he doesn't have the ability to peel.
Well, he did it. Yeah, he's got the early cooldown boots as well. The ghost is going to have a super short cooldown. The ulti pops and he walks right through all the plants. And KiwiKid has been turned into mulch this time around. You know what's great is actually, composting plants are actually worth a lot of energy. Mm-hmm. Woo! And now Nocturne's in the game.
Yeah. We'll keep talking, though. Interestingly enough, that gank was very effective for Darduk. He has a slight lead onto Santorin, and it's very difficult to stop that from happening as the ghost comes up, because it comes up so frequently, and every time Darduk plays Olaf, he rushes the Ionian Boots of Lucidity, the cooldown boots, so he has his ghost up even more quickly. So really, even though KiwiKid picked up a bunch of early kills, he's always going to do a fairly offensive build on Zyra, so unless he stays really far back, he's at danger of those Olaf ganks.
Yeah, it definitely is. So we see here a 1,000 gold lead for Energy, all said and done. A lot of that is the fact that this Jax is pretty far ahead here. He had looked to TP to the top lane and canceled it when he realized the fight wasn't going to happen. But that means he can once again not teleport back to his own lane. And Warlow can maybe try to catch back up over time. As we had seen Quash shove down the bot lane. Phoenix and GBM kind of trading back and forth. GBM actually getting slightly the better side of the trade. His mana's starting to run a little bit low. But he can maybe back up pretty soon. We can watch a replay of that. And yeah, it's...
Oh, man. So Kiwi Kid actually played that about as well as he could. He landed the double root on the two guys coming out of the Bard. But then Dardock just ran in from the side.
His plant actually betrayed him. A Bard Q tagged his plant and still tagged him, actually. It wasn't even the wall that got him. He was barely in range of his own plant triggering the stun. Kind of unlucky there for Kiwi Kid, but it happened. And either way, I think he was probably dead regardless. There were enough slows anyway. Either way, it was kind of funny.
Yeah, absolutely. Interesting how GBM also has gone tier early, and we'll do the catalyst later. So really just not looking to interact heavily with Phoenix whatsoever early on in the lane, which I think is reasonable. But it also loses a fair bit of the lane pressure that he was hoping to have with the Anivia. And it's going to be giving Phoenix a little bit more freedom to teleport or roam around and assist in what is probably going to be a fairly skirmish-heavy game with the way Dardock is going on Olaf.
One of the nice things about the Vladimir sort of rework is actually he's better at lasting under turret now because you can insta-tap the E and it sets up cast minions perfectly to just auto-attack them under turret. So just perma-shoving of Vladimir is actually less good than it was
before. Dardock,
just wants to kill Kiwi Kid. There's the Asher and they shut out the turret as well. So OQ's got nowhere to go. They're gonna just pile drive him. Phoenix came up as well to make sure it happened, burn the teleport and comes in. Liquid spending so much effort on this post-ultimate top lane.
Yeah, and I gotta say, even though Dardock is very smart in his positioning, I gotta put this a little bit on Santorin, who should be matching this or be ready for ganks elsewhere, because these are extremely telegraphed ganks. You know what the Ash Bard is trying to do. You know the inherent weakness of the Zarya versus the Olaf, so you either need to be up there to make the dive harder to do, or Kiwi Kid has to at least be under the turret so they can't easily turn off the turret without shutting anyone down. Quick double kill. Santorin trying to match. Let's see if Lorelei can outplay.
Well, they're doing a bit of damage there. He's going to get away from some of it, but now he's one hit away from death. Dodge is round. Final smack comes through, and Quash gets himself his first kill of the game. Up 50 minions already. This turret will take some damage. Teleport available for Lorelei, but he's still dead for 15 seconds and should lose this wave as well. And that means pretty good things for Energy trying to starve out this Aurelia and carrying through the Jax.
Dardock has Ghost, Quash, Burn Ghost in the past gank, so let's see if they go for it.
Now he's going to run. Exhaust is going to land, as is the Axe. And the taunt, the dodge rather, not going to mean too very much. Quas will get dropped. Ooh. Can't jump to Santorin quite in time.
Whoa.
And that means now Santorin actually getting hit up. And look at this. Dardock just does not care about anything at all. Gives no cares. Gets a double kill. 3-1 and 3 on this Olaf. Dardock is everywhere.
Wow. And just such discipline with the way Dardock is using his cooldowns. If you think about the double kill on the top lane, he didn't burn anything for that outside of his normal abilities. Then when he comes down to gank Quas, he doesn't burn his ult early. He only pops his ghost so that when he wants to kill Santorin, he pops ultimate and is immune to the knockup. He's always having the right spell available for the situation because he is only using what is necessary for the kills.
It's one of the nice things about the cooldown boots rush, right? Your spells are doing all your damage anyway. His Ragnarok is an 80-second cooldown. His ghost, 135. That's 2 minutes and change.
Mm-hmm.
When you consider he's already probably running the 10% reduction in the mastery tree in the first place by going down resolve, like
exactly
2 minute cooldown ghost, like that's almost Smite's cooldown. Like that's just super fast. It's better than a Moomoo ultimate. You can ghost in all the time.
Yeah, it is really effective. It'll be interesting to see what itemization path he goes next. He did Steric Skate yesterday. He's kind of going towards that again, but there's an Ash Arrow!
And it's still going to land on OQ. Bard will need to buy a couple more seconds. Here comes Lorelei.
Oh boy.
Looking for a bit to do. Actually stuns up Kiwi Kid because he got damaged by Kiwi's ultimate. Looking for a chase, and OQ can't do quite the damage, and Ezreal will walk away. GBM has to flash and wall to get himself out of the mid lane fight. As Phoenix had popped the Chemo Plague there, and Quas once again gets a lot of free time down in the bot lane. He has never actually left this lane.
Yeah, this is going to become a really tricky game for Energy because Team Liquid is winning so heavily in every area except the direct Jax versus Aurelia matchup. So it's going to be really hard to set up a 4-1 split push when their 4 is so much weaker than the 4 from Team Liquid. They're going for OQ as well.
Oh, misses the stun. Thanks for a couple minutes being in the way. OQ's still running around. Pops the ulti down. A lot of damage to Lorelei, but can't quite get him up. And that's going to be Dardock picking up yet another kill. 4-1 and 3 for him. This top lane will be probably dropping down, and Quas finally starts shoving in the bot lane. As Lorelei looks to make the recall here, he's only got 61 minions. He's been doubled already by Quas.
Yeah.
More die to the turret.
And basically, if Energy wants back in this game, Quas is going to have to be able to solo kill Lorlo. So I'm actually really curious whether Lorlo will continue to build Trinity Force or if he's going to go super defensive super early just to try and be a neutralizer, since I do feel like that's all they would need with how far ahead Dardock, Phoenix, and Fabi are.
Well, Lorlo doesn't believe the same thing. He's got his Sheen for himself. And by the way, it's an 1,800 gold deficit right now. Lorlo has 3,600 gold. Quas is 50% more than him at 54 right now. With a completed Trinity Force, half the Hex Drinker, or whatever it ends up being, you got to imagine Quas should be able to do a lot with this matchup here. Phoenix looking to do some battle with GBM. He's walked in and chunked him down a bit.
Yeah, Phoenix also is pretty substantially ahead of GBM, mainly because he's made such good use of his teleports, gotten the kills, and that's given him lane pressure. So GBM nearly taking the mid lane turret, but the cost has been just so high for GBM to sit in lane.
We're going to see a protobelt come out of Phoenix here, so he wants to blink in and continue to be kind of a frontliner here for the squad. And the name of the game is getting into fights. Quas now actually going to be joining in with OQ and Kiwi Kid. You figure if they're continually picking on the Zyra, how just put the Jax next to him? And you can no longer do that. It'll be an overall trade of turrets, though, as Fabi's in the bot lane. So those just kind of become equivalent situations. But Energy spent three people, whereas Liquid only spent one to do that.
Yeah, and OQ really needs to complete some of these items. Until he has Iceborne, he's going to be incredibly weak.
Sharrow comes
trying
across.
Trying to get a catch.
Maybe Liquid gets something, and they're all stuck, and yeah, it's going to stun, but then gets canceled up by the Bartleby. Kind of a waste, actually, but they re-stun on the Quas. That's going to be Jax dropping down. Yes, it is. Dardock on a rampage, and Phoenix wants more. OQ stunned up by the Rift Herald and Matt's Bard Q.
Oh, he'd need to dodge the Root here. Got to be pretty careful.
Flash from Kiwi. Root comes out. I guess the cooldown was still missing for a few more seconds, but it's still another flash missed. And Liquid really just taking over this game. Tardock is everywhere.
Yeah, and Matt and Fabi have been pretty on point with their abilities as well to set up more crowd control to allow these Dardock plays to happen. But yeah, I absolutely agree. His Olaf play has been very strong just based on where he's positioned. And we talk about the ability to get tankiness against the Jax. Having the damage reduction from the Herald here is really going to help Lorlo.
Yeah, he's going to kind of need that to help weather the storm here unless he can get his gold back to close. And might see him come out of that one. There we go. Does go to Lorlo. Yeah, we saw CLG miss Q earlier, and Smithy accidentally took it when they both walked over the sigil, and the game decided it likes junglers more than top laners. Or just, I don't know, dislikes Canadians? Who knows? But either way, it is Lorlo who gets it this time around. Did you say understandable?
Yeah. Sorry.
You're not a Zale. Yeah. He's more Canadian than you. I think you're no longer the token Canadian.
It's true, actually. That title has been taken.
He's also taking baldness from me. Like, I don't know if we have anything unique anymore. Zale is just crushing it.
Man, I feel like you're only allowed to make fun of your own receding hairline.
I don't know.
It becomes rude when you start talking about
other people. Yeah. I feel like we're similar. I think it's okay. Oh, well. Moving on with this one, though, Liquid just honestly crushing it and Phoenix pushing in the mid lane. That turret's down below half HP. They'll probably get reinforcements soon enough. They want to knock that one down. OQ's been sent to hold the mid lane. And Energy are actually going to be sending GBM into the same spot to reinforce him.
Yeah, GBM really just going to continue to try and get pressure in the mid lane. But it's definitely high time the TL start turning their attention towards Drake 17 minutes in, because so many of their ganks have been prioritized around the top side. It's actually kind of shocking when you think about it now, 17 minutes in, with how frequent Dardock has been top lane and how Centaurin hasn't been there, how Centaurin hasn't got the dragon, with how far ahead Quas was, and how Centaurin was in the bottom jungle. I think that's a pretty decent-sized failure by Quas and Centaurin to not make that happen.
Yeah, Jax could have killed that thing super fast. He was level 6 plenty early into the game, and there are about 12 minutes now where he was level 6 and didn't go for a dragon. So, totally agree, Jax. I didn't think about it, but you're absolutely right. And now it looks like they're attempting a dive onto Quas, and even though there's a turret there, Dardock shrugs off a few attacks, throws another axe down, and Quas now knows he's under threat. Lorlo's still down a level, but seems to be okay with it. Close to the Triforce himself. Merc Treads and a Vamp Scepter now done for Quas. Is he going towards maybe a Ruin King? Arrow not quite going to land. GBM dodges away from it, and Phoenix going to cool out. Oh, still got actually hit by the Glacial Storm. And
yeah, and this is actually, even though that Ash Arrow missed, which is great for Energy, it's still a really difficult moment in the game for them, because right now they're in a situation where Quast isn't applying any threat and is actually in a high-risk area for getting picked off because Energy has no actual control in their jungle. They're weaker in every position except the Jax. And Santorin is actually still farming on the other side of the map. So if there's a concentrated push by anywhere, really, for Team Liquid, they're going to be able to find an advantage.
Yeah, almost definitely. GBM just has to play the wave clear game perfectly, and Kiwi get to play the disengage. And looks like Liquid was unable to push because of the tools that were available to the red team. But look at this. They've moved somewhere else. The concentrated push is in the bot lane, and well, guess what? That turret's taking a whole lot of damage. Yes, GBM's wave clearing some, but then Phoenix goes in with Thardok, forces the flash out of that Anivia. Respects the wall, runs around, takes some damage, doesn't really care though. This turret taking plenty of punishment. Quast now in. Phoenix pulls away. That turret though, nearly dead.
But even that's costing them a massive minion wave up in the top side because Quast had to run down to stop them from diving. Really, Energy just doing all they can to not have everything fall apart for them as they continue to try and scale.
We're definitely getting worse here. You can see Liquid running back and forth, using Magical Journeys from Matt's Bard to make rotations even a little bit faster. Resources staying up thanks to the Ocean Drake, which not the most incredible this sort of mid-game part, but still helping them in its own way. And back and forth to go with a 4,000 gold. Looking for more turrets to knock down. Up seven kills, up one turret, up one Drake.
Yeah, so now it'll be a question of whether they can transition all of the early kills on Olaf into a decent win. And of all the Olaf we're starting to see, and even some Olaf bans, hyper late game, it's not that impressive of a pick. When the enemy AD carry and there's a lot of damage on the other team, being immune to CC just seems to be a little bit less valuable since there's not this like agreed upon Olaf build that is great. If you build damage to allow you to kill someone very quickly, you usually die while you're running in. But if you build full tank, by the time people get end game stats with like 2000 base health, you're not doing enough damage to solo them up before they can do 4,000 year health back. So really, it's the early and mid game where Dardok has to make his mark, especially since he's picked up a lot of the kills. If he was like a 0-1-9 Olaf right now and all the kills were on Vladimir and Ashe, it wouldn't be a problem. But he picked 5 of the kills up, so he really has to make sure that Team Liquid close out this game handy.
Under some risk, but didn't panic too badly. Magical drained it up to this top side, did not get rooted up. He's okay for now. GBM the right in front of this one. Spots Lorlo, plenty of damage. Wall still on cooldown, though. It's enough to force the flash anyway, though, as the Zyra roots are coming out. QB Kid forcing that summoner out of him.
Moves like those are still very beneficial in trying to scale for Energy. They got a 0-4 OQ and a 0-kill Anivia, so the more they can farm to make this gold closer percentage-wise, the better. Burning Lorlo's flash gives them more opportunity to stall.
Lorlo has to play defensively even longer. Bardolphy not quite going to land. Santorin walks away from that one. And
this is high cost. Lorlo has flash down, so even if he does go to stop Squash, he would get soloed. So like they have to send a whole bunch of people back here. And this is the effect of Team Liquid missing their last few shots. Remember, Fabby's missed Ash Arrow in the mid lane,
right,
and then Matt's missed Bard Ultimate there in the jungle. So Team Liquid has been trying to convert on these advantages, but they've missed a few times in a row.
They've been trying to play sort of five-man group against a 4-1 split push, and if you can get in the 5v4, yeah, it'll work great. But if it doesn't, Jax keeps getting farther ahead. As Jat was saying, I just put it in more words. It's probably not useful, but
well,
it's about to go down.
I like that Energy is committing to this as well, because it's not like Quas is going for a team fight build. He's going for a split push build.
Very much so.
We saw KFO do this once where he was 5-0 on Jax last week, and then he built the Steryx Gauge as the second item, and you're like, well, that's not really great for split pushing. It's more just so you can avoid being bursted. And they didn't have threats split pushing or in team fights. So at least now Energy has a split push threat, and they're just trying to stall out with their four-man unit. As long as they keep avoiding the Ash Arrow and the Bard Ultimates, which is a pretty tall task, they're going to be fine.
Looks like they're avoiding Dardok's ability to have any health as well, knocking him down a nice wall. And despite the fact that Olaf can ignore CC, he can't ignore terrain at all. He's running Ghost, so Anivia ends up being a really good pick into Olaf as well. And actually, looking at the pick ban order, I'm curious. Olaf was picked into Anivia. Liquid picked that in their last round after the champion has already shown. So Dardok didn't care about that potential weakness. GBM gets a really fortunate situation where he gets to play into this matchup. But Anivia, Ezreal, and Zyra are great defensive assets. Like, they are actually well set up to make this 4-1 work.
Yeah, especially now that the gold has become a little bit more reasonable. It's not a 3,000 gold early game lead, it's a 3,000 gold mid game lead, and that's much more manageable. Until Team Liquid starts stacking up Mountain Drakes to make Energy have smaller margins with how long they can wait in mid lane, it's going to be a game that Energy needs to, they keep you to walk in the line because still, even with how well they're stalling, if Fabi lands an arrow onto the right target with no McHales or QSS or cleanse in sight, it's a kill. Same thing can be true for Matt's Bard ultimate.
All right, well, you can see right away Mountain Drake is the issue, and if you're already stacked up as five and there's no turrets to hide behind, it's generally going to be pretty easy for Liquid to get it. So good of them to keep the waves pushed up enough that they always had the ward control. Take this out without much effort. This was an earned Drake over the fact that they've been keeping the lanes pushed up. So good job, Liquid.
Yeah.
And a nice one to pick up in the 20-ish minute mark. Next one coming up is a second Mountain Drake, which is actually ideal now for Liquid because it feels like they do need to get that chip damage into these turrets or even threaten Baron.
Yeah, very true. I do have to say, though, that Energy won a game fairly similar to this last week against Echo Fox, where Echo Fox, it was game one of the series, Echo Fox was controlling the majority of the dragons and had a reasonable goal lead for most of the game, but Energy trusted their scaling in the game and were able to build generally tanky by the end of it. So Quas has built his two offensive items. A little bit surprised to actually see him go Blade of the Rune King instead of for the Gunblade. I feel like the Gunblade is more common, but this is still going to be quite good for split pushing. Basically, even though Team Liquid scales well, Energy could make an argument that they scale better. Kiwi Kid will do much more damage than Matt's Bard in the late game. Blue-billed Ezreal can be very elusive for Team Liquid, who might not be able to dive on top of him. And if GBM gets the right zone control, he's crazy. And then when Jax gets 5 to 6 items, he is way stronger than Aurelia.
Yeah.
So that's got to be what Energy is going for. They had the experience of winning a game like this last week, and since they fell behind early, they're just trying to do it again.
Yeah, honestly, there's no even easy targets for Lolo. Even if he were to be effective on this Aurelia, Ezreal should be able to kite away pretty reasonably. Just Arcane Shift after the Blade Surge comes in. Kiwi Kid, as long as he just dumps his cooldowns, the plants can live on without him, and that'll be pretty reasonable as well. And you're right, even just outside of champion skilling, purpose-wise, it's not great for Lorlo here on this Aurelia. So I can see very good things in Energy's future if they can keep this one alive. And as the game has slowed down, it feels like that just might be the case. Matt playing for the ward control, and Liquid, to their credit, are really darkening the vision around this Baron pit. Liquid have gotten rid of all the vision. There's only one ward really anywhere near to the other side of the wall from Energy.
Yeah.
They can't really see the Baron base.
And for how decisive Team Liquid was in the early game, they've been able to find far fewer plays here in the mid game. We say they missed their last two shots of the Bard ultimate and the Ash Arrow, but that was 8 minutes ago. The cooldowns aren't that long. They're just not taking the shots anymore because they're not seeing the opportunities for a big play.
And as a Canadian, you must know the famous Wayne Gretzky quote, "You miss 100% of the shots you don't take." I hope it's actually him. I'm pretty sure it is.
I think it was a Gandalf quote? No. I think it was a Michael Jordan poster, but I think Wayne Gretzky has said similar things, like all the great players throughout time are very willing to take the shots because they want to be the ones who win the game. They don't want to wait for the other team to lose it.
Yeah, and this is Liquid missing a bunch of shots they're not taking right now, not finding the opening. There's OQ almost getting slow. Dardock can't quite land it, though. They're really pushing in the top, so they're trying to split the team up. Roots come across, and a nice wall blocks out Dardock, who's just stuck
there.
That's
a big one.
Bardo buys some time. Here comes the engage. Asher lands. GVM is going to get slaughtered here in this one. Santorin running. OQ nearly dead. Hemoplague might get him. Unstoppable as Dardock, as they have picked off one. Now a second as the Zyra pops, and this will be Liquid taking a 2-0. Going into the mid lane even farther.
They hit both the shots. Matt lands a great Bard ultimate, and then the Shane of the Ash Arrow was actually super deadly. GBM couldn't respond to that whatsoever. The question will be, are these death timers long enough for Team Liquid to take a bunch, and how well can they defend Quas? Because Quas fully committed, never tried to teleport back in, and he's gaining ground on the bottom half of the map.
Yeah, he's equalizing part of this inhibitor take, but look at that. Lorlo was scary enough that Quas couldn't make his presence really known. Jumps in again on the turret. He tries to ignore some of the damage. He will not get stunned off by Lorlo, but look at the health he's losing. Quas will just die for this.
Die.
Puts on the dodge, then goes, are you going to live? You're probably not going to live, but you're going to try to live. He flashes, and it's going to be Lorlo picking up the kill. Kind of close, actually. You can see the tools that Quas would have had, but lost too much health. And you can now see that Liquid, with an advantage in kills and a middle inhibitor dead, are looking great.
Yeah, the middle inhibitor is really critical to be able to break against the Anivia. It means if they siege another turret, they're going to be able to get some type of flank positioning. And watching this, OQ had just gotten a little greedy running up front, but that's not the reason they died. He shifts away, and it's really the tempered fate for Matt catching Santorin, GBM, and King Kid. And watch Fabi's timing. Boom, right onto GBM and Santorin, as well as Matt chaining the Bard stun. Phoenix as well, able to flash in to just take them clean off the turret.
And what was nice by Liquid is there are three members who are so willing to dive, who are tanky against turrets. Phoenix, Darduk, and Lorlo all happy to run right in there, make sure that Fabi and Matt are safe to follow up, and those kills just came through cleanly. Really beautiful stuff here by Liquid. Matt gets the ulti up again, makes Jeevan walk to the backside, but that could still mean a possible death. Darduk runs in, lands the axe slow, but doesn't want to go any farther. Loses the Steric's cooldown and walks away. Spirit visits up for him.
OQ poking relatively nicely. Reduces his healing with the Executioner's Calling as well. That was definitely another attempt for Team Liquid. This one, not as successful. Gold's still really close. As long as Energy's able to keep clearing out these minions, and as long as Quas is able to secure farm down in the bottom side, I'm wondering if it's worth it for Team Liquid to just go and kill Quas. Like, that is one thing about him having the Ghost. He kind of guarantees he can run away from Darduk as long as he dodges one of the axes with a Leap Strike.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'd just say it would be super easy for Darduk and Lorlo to just gank him because Energy's four-man squad isn't strong enough to do anything about it. But with the Ghost, it kind of changes that equation.
I kind of agree. So even though Quas' scoreline is 1-3, he's actually gotten plenty of turret damage and plenty of farm for himself. And he was right around the bottom side of the map. Didn't find much to do with it, though, and will simply back out. Lorlo still has about 6 to 7 minutes left on his Rift Herald buff, so he's still got that power to help equalize what the Jax is doing to him. And let a clean take on your second Mountain Drake here for Liquid. And that'll be the last one, because Elder Dragon's next up.
Yep, 6 minute cooldown on the Dragon respawn. If it's going to spawn after 35 minutes, it will be an Elder Drake instead of an Elemental. So we actually got to see in our last game between Immortals and Envy a double Mountain Drake with an Elder Drake. Now fast that can take Baron. You got a couple seconds when a double Mountain Drake team starts Baron. Obviously Team Liquid's team isn't the best at it, but the double Mountain Drake will make them so.
Not too shabby. We'll see what happens though in this one. Darduk once again losing his Steric's, taking plenty of poke damage here and backing out. OQ had gone for an early detour into Executioner's Calling, but now is going towards that Ruin Pick as he should be.
Here we go. And this is decision time right now. They know they're in it. Will Energy try and steal? Will they try and harass? And will Quas teleport? All these questions will be answered right now.
Looking for it. Santorin is getting locked up by Bard, which means there's not really any time to get across there. Ash arrows early, but it doesn't matter. He still can't get across in time. Takes the magical journey back out, but Santorin's still on the run. Phoenix in the front lines goes for the kill and will pick up Santorin. The jungler still does go down, plus the Baron picked up for Liquid. Quas is splitting, but I don't know how much more he can get.
Yeah, and how much more can TL get? Because they're not even responding to Quas. They know they killed Santorin, they know they have energy low, and they know they have Baron, so they're going for inhibitor number two.
The Quas going for the summoner teleport. I think he could just recall, though, honestly. He wasn't going to save the inhibitor anyway, so I think a loss in cooldown, threatening to TP back to the bot
They're
lane, could have
to
gone
win.
To the play. But yeah, Liquid threatening to win right now on turret number one. 5v4 Santorin at 15 seconds on a GBM, popped into the egg, but Darduk has aggro, has to walk away. Lorlo dangerously low. Phoenix goes in the back line, pops the pool, look for GBM. They can't get him, though. He pops the shield and gets away. Darduk almost dead in the battle against OQ, and he gets shut down by Anivia. GBM takes him out, and yes, that team is alive. And imagine if Quas had teleport right now. He could threaten the bottom lane. Oh, Phoenix, though, does take down OQ, picked up the kill, heals back up, and runs away. Four alive for each squad. Lolo able to recall back and hold the bot lane alive. Liquid, they do get one of the Nexus turrets.
Yeah.
Otherwise, a trade and kills and a retreat.
And the second inhibitor, the protobelt kill at the end from Phoenix, really caught OQ off guard. He is not having a very fun time on Ezreal with how far behind he is. And yeah, a little bit of missed decision by Energy right here. Like, TL very clearly are making the calls to go in right now, 30 minutes in. And I like the call to try and go to end because they had already killed Santorin and they were much stronger in team fights. They get a lot of CC on a Quas, so Quas has almost no impact in this fight. And they get an egg on a GBM. So all the damage is pretty much gone for Energy since Kid and OQ are so far behind. But they are trying to push in to double Nexus turrets, which makes things a little bit difficult. Phoenix Protobelts gets just the edge of the E onto OQ there, and I think maybe if he didn't shoot that last Mystic shot, he would have kept his life.
Maybe so, yeah.
Definitely not a good game for OQ, but pretty good game here for Phoenix.
I mean, you see how that bottom lane started, too. KiwiKid was 3-0 to start. OQ got a bunch of assists, and then they went like a combined 0-9 since then. No kills picked up for the bottom lane. 9 deaths, I think, across the two of them over time, and really rough stuff.
Yeah, and when these split push games break, they can break really hard, especially when the split push is the only one that has gold distribution on the team. Team Liquid now with two inhibitors down, Baron buff, and a third one available to be pushed. are going to go for the middle of him reaction because of respawn right now, but it's still going to be very tough for Energy to defend.
Drawdot cutting back and forth, getting away from the Glacial Storm. Bit of a root on a Fabi. Kiwi Kid, look at the damage up on him! Nozonius pop by Phoenix. That could mean a setup for a stun. They kite away. Do not get tempered faded. And they're going to be okay with this one. Quas pops the dodge, runs away.
I tried to zone with that Counter-Strike, but there's no sustained zoning. So it's nice siege there for TL to get it. Now they're just going to go for number three.
Maybe a little bit more can happen then as they move on to the bot lane here. Top and middle inhibitor already dead, as you mentioned. The third one, as you said, Jat, and here we go. Baron buff still on for a few more seconds. Looking at this one here. Bit of damage coming across. Jax goes in for the stun, lands on Alola. Plenty of damage there. The Zyra to follow up as well. Plenty of punishment across. Liquid losing a lot of HP, but the tanks are still alive and they can still push forward. Ash is nearly untouched. Fabi putting out plenty of damage. Another stun lands out of Phoenix, but he can heal himself back up. Does so, and he's just healthy. He's fine. Quas has to run back to heal. By the way, turrets are still dying thanks to minions across the map. And oh, see how much they're getting done right there.
Yeah,
Quas can be keeping alive.
Quas can just never really get in on these fights. No one on Energy can really get in on these fights. Just with how strong Phoenix is right now, walking through Vladimir is incredibly difficult. When you would get there, you're going to get CC'd by Matt and Fabi. Add the exhaust on top of it, and it just makes it kind of an impossible task for Quas to really do anything in a 5v5. So with all their base being dead, it's hard to imagine Energy getting this game unless Team Liquid make a mistake. At the moment, Team Liquid's just going to group right back up. Now that they've healed, they don't even need the Baron empowered minions because it's an Explosion Inhibitor, and I think they're going to do that push again.
They might just do this one right now. Dardock looking for Kiwi Kid, almost a little bit alone, but now he's got Lorlo, and down they go. The support is dead. Kiwi Kid just being attacked constantly.
And that's just going to make it easier. There's only one Nexus turret up right now, so they can easily take the third inhibitor in a 5v4, or they could push straight up for the win, but the death timer is long enough. I think they're going to do this, and then maybe go for the win after.
And Matt just walking up to the inhibitor, attacking it with his bar damage, and the other team comes in and makes it go down much, much faster. So there we go. All three inhibitors dead for the time being. And this could be the end now for Energy. 13 seconds on Kiwi Kid. Does have his ultimate when he comes back up. And that will be a fair bit of damage that goes towards Zonya's Hourglass, which he won't complete before the game ends, most likely.
Yeah, not a great way for Energy to try and initiate right here, so they're really at risk of just being poked down and losing this one. Team Liquid's kind of slow playing this one, forcing Energy
damage
to engage.
Turret's nearly dead. Stun only lands on a Lorlo, doesn't mean much. Phoenix goes right back into the front line. Stun on a Quas. That could be a kill picked up as Jax runs away. An ulti on a GBM as well as OQ means they're not part of the fight just yet. And the back line's kind of split off. A stun on an OQ, and it's out of the Nexus now. Down below half HP. Fabi stays on it. So does Lorlo. The kills don't matter. It's the Nexus. It's the game. And 36 minutes, Liquid takes down game one.
Hard to argue with their execution that game. They jumped out of the gate really quickly, kind of found themselves in the mid game. Regrouped, were able to land the initiations time and time again from Matt and Fabi, and they get that 36-minute, fairly one-sided victory.
Really, honestly impressive how this game was played by Liquid. When it started out as a 4-1 victory in the 2-on-2, where Kiwi Kid suddenly has 5,000 gold and OQ's got enough assists to finish a tier and more, you figure Energy are looking so amazing, and then Dardock comes in and gets a little bit done, and then Phoenix comes in, picks up a double kill, and suddenly all that gets equalized. And then Dardock keeps going up to that top lane. And he keeps killing the 3-0 or 3-1 Zyra to the point where the Zyra ended up 3-7. He actually went from 3-0-1 to 3-7-2.
He did. And I mean, Kiwi Kid actually ended up doing the most damage to champions for his team on Zyra, because that's why the champion is kind of ridiculous, even when he died doing a bunch of damage. But it was really, at the end of the day, all of the initiation that they were able to create to make it so Quas couldn't get effectiveness out of his split push despite his lead. And that's a really difficult balance to strike. So credit to Team Liquid for making it work.
Yeah, credit Team Liquid.